Good morning. This is Bruce Neal with the Lenawee Historical Museum in Adrian, Michigan. We're here to show you the three cars that have been built in Adrian. So we're starting with the first one, which is called the Murray. It's 1902. It's 119 years old now, and we're happy to have it here to show it to you. It got its start in Adrian by the general manager of the church manufacturing company, machine shop actually, on the east side of Adrian, whose manager decided he wanted a new car in 1901. Well, he ordered it, picked it up in Detroit, and then started to drive it home. He did. What he saw was one car on the trip home, one other car in 1901. Imagine that. But unfortunately, he only got a little more than halfway home when his new car broke down. So what he did was take it to the farmer that was right nearby. You know, farmers were always friendly then. They decided they would keep it in the barn while Mr. Clement, who the general manager's name was, would ride the train back to Adrian, which he did. Well, when he got back to Adrian, he said, "My company can make a better car than that." So that got him into the idea of making their own car at the church manufacturing company. They worked hard and diligently on getting the car ready, and by early 1902, they had a model ready. And that's what you see right in front of you. It's a small buggy enhanced car. You can see the buggy in it, of course, but it had a number of features that were pretty advanced at the time. It had a 5-horsepower single cylinder liquid cooled engine capable of driving it through a chain drive about 20 miles an hour. And at the time, it seemed like a pretty good car. The company was quite proud of it, and they took it over to Chicago, to the new Chicago Auto Show, where if you had a car, that's where you went with it. And they took it, showed it, and it was well received. Tests and all seemed to do quite well. So the company got geared up. They ordered several thousands of dollars worth of materials, actually $60,000, which later proved to be the downfall of materials and parts for the car, and got it going to building it. Now, they had the skill and the know-how to build it, but their problem turned out to be, in the long run, that they didn't gear up for large production to build the parts cheaply enough. So as a car, it turned out to be well-made, but it was essentially handmade. And so at the end of the year, they looked and see how they were doing. Well, they found out they were losing money on just about every one of them. This is after the first year, year and a half of about 200 cars having been made. So they decided, well, they'll get out of the car business, but not without one more effort. And then they went after the next car they made was called the Lenawee, of course, named after our county. This was an improved version of the Murray, which had a 8-horsepower engine, had a better radiator, back seat, and instead of a tiller bar that you have on the Murray, had a steering wheel. Well, this car ended up going to cost about $1,400 more. That was quite a lot more than the $650 that the Murray cost. So I ended up building only maybe a dozen of the Lenawees before, again, it was too costly to produce, even at the increased price. And then they ended up getting out of the automotive business. And that was the end of automobiles being made in Adrian for the first 3 or 4 years. And this was 1904. So that was it until another car was proposed in 1907, 1908, and that was called the Page Adrian. This was due by the Page Fence Company, which was a prominent fence manufacturer in Adrian, but somehow that car never actually got into production. Only a couple prototypes were made. And that was it until 1909, when a couple of gentlemen from Detroit bought the rights to a car called the Gyroscope. This car was a design. It was a little strange on the engine, but it was supposedly had been engineered, and they wanted to manufacture it in Detroit, but it was a hard time finding a location. So one of the principals of the company was from Adrian. They came down to Adrian and looked, and they found the factory from the Lion Fence Company. The Lion Fence was another fence company that had been acquired by another company, and the factory was available. So with that, they found the Lion name was already painted on the building. So I guess that's gonna be the name of our company. We're gonna call it the Lion. That was only a few blocks from here in the museum on Logan Street here in Adrian. And with that, they started to get ready to manufacture an automobile here in Adrian. Now this was a bigger, more modern car. And if we'll go over and take a look at it, we can see that. Here we are back again. We're with a Lion car, Adrian's probably most famous car that was made here in Adrian. As I was saying, 1909, a gentleman from Detroit located a spot in Adrian at the Lion Fence Company factory to manufacture their car. They did this in 1909. By early 1910, January actually, they had prototypes running and they were ready to go with the car. Had a big gala celebration in Adrian, thanking the Adrian people for their support for the car, and a big party and band playing and send off to take the cars that they had three ready to go to the Chicago Auto Show. So the people of Adrian got to have a great viewing of them and a gala party to send off to Chicago to show the world their new car made in Adrian. Now the Lion, turns out, was an assembled car. The company bought the components like the engine, transmission, differential, body, wheels and tires, of course, and just assembled it in Adrian. So that was done, what was done at the factory. It turned out to be a pretty good selection of parts as the car was well received. It was a upper medium price car, kind of like a Buick might be today. And it turned out to be quite well received with 40 horsepower, front engine, rear drive, layout the same as conventional cars were for well on to the next 70 years. So Adrian's claim to fame also included a touring car, which had the back seat, a roadster, which you see pictured here, a single seat, and a gentleman's speedster, didn't have a top and sat lower. So it was kind of the sports car of the bunch. So company got going in 1910, produced cars in 1910, 11, 12, did quite well, made improvements to the cars, seemed to be well received, sold quite a few hundred cars, doing well. Adrian was very proud of their company. Almost 300 employees by 1912 until a fateful night of June 2nd, 1912, when a massive fire struck the factory. Now, it was said that a settling light on one of the cars may have been the cause of it. Nobody knows for sure, but it was a fire that soon took the whole plant because there was a lot of solvents there and the factory was largely wood. So 150 cars, unfortunately, were lost in the fire, as well as two prototypes for a Lion 30. This is a Lion 40 for 40 horsepower. 30 was to be a 30 horsepower, less expensive car, costing only about $1,000 versus the $1,600 for the Lion 40. Two prototypes lost in the fire. So that was the end of it. The company tried to get started again, actually found another location, but they could not raise the money. There was $10,000-$15,000 the local people gave to get a stock offering in gear, and that was $100,000 worth. But that kind of stood quiet for 6 months and not enough buyers. And with the end of the, after 6 months, that was pretty much the end of the company. So we'll never know in Adrian what we might have had here, but it was indeed a company that the local residents were very proud of, and they they wanted to make good for their lion. So anyway, the lion you see here is a roadster model, single seat. It originally came from South Dakota, made its way out there, came back here, was restored, and 20 years ago was given to the museum for all of Adrian and Lenawee County. So we're very pleased and happy to have it here and glad to tell the story. Thank you very much. Do come out and see it anytime. We're open Fridays and Saturdays, 10 to 2 here at the museum in Adrian. There's no admission charge, so we're happy to show you the lion and the Murray.
Here at the museum, we also have a display of Al Myers, the original founder of the Myers aircraft that was started in Tecumseh. Al is actually in the Smithsonian Institute in Washington, D.C. Al was the first one to develop a biplane with an all-metal fuselage, aluminum fuselage. He also produced those as a training plane for World War II. Had a contract. The plane was so easy to fly and safe to fly that they would start their pilots out in those, and then they would move into the regular military training planes. But they used them as their basic lesson to get into those. When the war was over, Myers went into building what they called the 145, which was a small two-place aircraft. They went from that, and then they needed something to help supplement the income, so they started manufacturing aluminum boats in early 1950, that were still produced today, and that carried them through for Al to develop from the 145. He had a model 165 that worked on, but he didn't like it. He didn't like the looks of it, so he went on to develop the Myers 200, which became one of the safest aircraft manufactured at the time. It never had an accident where the plane was at fault. Everything had been, any of that did crash were the fault of the pilot, and they had a record of safety that hasn't been matched, I don't believe. The Myers 200 was also a business executive type aircraft, four passenger, used for racing also in their class. They manufactured one that altered it for a man called Peter Glotman that flew around the world with it. It flew across the ocean, over around Europe, came back around and completed his attempt then. He tried for a second attempt. He flew out from California to Hawaii, landed in Hawaii, refueled, took off, and was never seen again. So between the Myers aircraft and the Myers aluminum boats, they also manufactured Jeep tops for Sears Roebuck Company in the 50s up to 1970. They were still manufacturing for Sears Roebucks at the time. That they had large contracts for the military also for Jeep tops. And that some of the Jeep tops were manufactured. They sent them to the Antarctic, super insulated with their own 1,000 BTU little furnace inside just to keep it warm so it would operate. The government, they had many contracts with the government. They had a good record with them for dependability on the things that they made. They made things from small parts to the major parts for the Jeeps. They made pontoons that they airlifted parts into Vietnam era that they would drop in for the pontoons were made for bridges, temporary bridges that they could move